need motivation. My one solution is my queen, cause she stays strong. Yeah, yeah. She is always in my corner, right there when I wanna. All these other girls are tempting, but I'm empty when you're gone. And they say, do you need me? Do you think I'm pretty? Do I make?
Give me three sayings or three things that mom told you that stuck with you for the rest of your life.
Life. Now, my mom was a teacher. As a matter of fact, my mom is now 80 and still a teacher.
Wow.
Will never stop teaching. She's retired a million times. She always finds a way to get back into the system because she just loves it. And there are a few things she said to me and then a few things by her example that both my sister and I think will take with us forever. Right. One of the things she said to me very early o'clock, because I was always tall and a little bit lean, which only works for you after you leave high school.
Okay.
Okay, in primary school. And in high school particularly, I had names like Mantis, short for praying mantis, Tolly, Twin Towers.
Oh my goodness.
It was not cute. It was not cute at all.
Oh no.
And mommy always used to say to me, people only pelt stones at a laden tree. It's only the mangoes on that tree sweet and that tree is laden, they'll throw stones at it.
Very true.
Which means you have something they want. So criticism became a good thing for me.
Okay.
It always has spurred me on to do well, to achieve, and to sort of brush it off.
Oh.
It makes me feel, honestly, better about myself. I know that sounds slightly warped, as if I'm a sadist.
Right.
But that has really served me well, because often when you are doing something a little bit different, stepping outside of everybody else's comfort zone, or taking a risk that others would like to but are afraid to, they criticize.
Yeah.
You know, and my parents have always encouraged Dee and I to do what we want to do, work hard, and take risk.
Yes.
You know, and that saying, every time I'm getting my butt kicked, I remember that.
Yes.
You know?
Now I know.
Yes, so always remember that nobody pelts stones at a barren tree.
Nobody pelts stones at a barren tree.
So that's one.
Yes.
Two, and this is mom's example, my mother is genuinely kind to everyone.
Okay.
Now, she could be very tough and mean, as Miss Fitzwilliam. She had a meter stick. In those days, you could spank.
Oh, yes. Ooh, yes. Oh, yes.
Crawling.
Spank.
Yeah, that meter stick. Trauma. But all of my life, I clearly remember mommy's students coming home and spending time with her. You know, those whose parents worked late, she would do homework with these kids. She always liked the ones who excelled and the ones who gave her a lot of trouble. Yeah.
She would have liked
it. Remarkable. She loved my sister and I.
Yeah.
Because we did give her a little bit of trouble.
Yeah.
But that said to me always that, you know, if you're given a lot in life, you have a responsibility to give back and do so with joy. You know, whatever she does, she enjoys tremendously.
Yeah.
So even when, which used to scare my sister and I, because even to this day, she just stopped random people. She sees a young man smoking outside the supermarket. She would say, darling, hi, what's your name? And how old are you? You know that could kill you? And then she'd launch into a whole lecture about smoking and moms,
oh,
and then he'd moms, and then the cigarette will disappear.
Yeah.
And she'd keep at
it.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
And she's that kind of person, you know? So even in simple interactions, she always is considerate, very firm, and that has served both my sister and I in good stead in terms of keeping us grounded, but also having that sense of, I don't know what it is, civic duty is what you would call it, I guess, in terms of our fellow man. Whether we are here or abroad, we both lived in America for a while, you know, we travel the world. Trinidad is emphatically home. But we feel very strongly in whatever we do, there's always room to give back.
Okay. All right. And tell me about number three.
Number three.
That was only two.
Shame. And then the other thing mom taught us without saying it, my sister has now put it into words. My mom is a total girly girl.
Okay.
And Dionys calls it show up and blow up. In other words, if you're going to leave home, put yourself together and look decent.
Yes.
And as I said, my mom, very simple country girl, but just always, always glamorous. A little lipstick, you know, she would not leave home without her lipstick.
Awesome.
Always well put together.
Well, that's why.
But when I remember right after Aylan was born, and this is like right after, a week after my child is born, I was bending over to pick him up and she said to me, "Ooh, Wens, that tummy girl, we're going to have to do something about it."
Oh my goodness!
Excuse me, I just had a baby!
Yeah.
Like the snapback is not that real or quickly.
Really?
But you know, but not, that's just mom.
Yeah.
Like, you know, she expects her kids to look a certain way all the time.
She
demands a very high standard of herself. And she doesn't even realize it. She does it in such a sweet way. So both my sister and I feel obligated. You know, it's been instilled in us from birth. We couldn't go outside to play unless we had on shoes and combed our eyebrows.
Oh,
whose mother makes them? Not your hair.
Yeah, eyebrows.
Because the hair had to be done. I mean, like, you know, get up in the morning, brush your teeth, say your prayers, have breakfast, comb your hair, and then you could do whatever you want. Even during the holidays, the hair had to be done. But you know, if her eyebrows were like disheveled, she was constantly neatening them. She's like, "Okay, now you can go."
I'm yeah.
Like, who does that? My mother. And that again has served us in good stead, because how you present, whether you like it or not, is very important in this world.
Very.
Janine, you remember Michelle Obama in 2008, pre-Barack winning Democratic nod. Everybody thought she was a hot mess. She was an angry black woman.
But she was.
She just didn't pull herself together.
No.
She looked like a soccer mom when he just started, you know, and came into our consciousness. She was always bright. She was always witty. She was always fabulous. But we couldn't hear her because we didn't like seeing her. The minute she pulled herself together, stopped tweezing the eyebrows to death, so she stopped looking like a witch.
Right.
Softer eyebrows. She's a beautiful woman. And I'm like, but she was beautiful back then too.
She was.
She just didn't pull herself together as well.
Yeah.
And that makes a huge difference in the way in which the world perceives you, whether you like it or not.
Most definitely.
Coming up next.
In high school, I was like Fido. Very, very narrow hips. I did have a waist, but you couldn't tell because my hips were so narrow. Very small boobs and a giant, you know, like just long and skinny. And which that worked for modeling. You know, I started my first paid modeling job was when I was 11.
Wow.
For Bosco Holder.